Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. Please stand. We're going to start this morning with Christ the Lord is risen today. We'll just do a verse of that and we're going to go right into Man of Sorrows.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Hallelujah. Sons of men and angels say, hallelujah. Raise your joys and triumphs high. Hallelujah. Sing ye heavens and earth reply. Been on Jesus lay. Silent as he stood abused, beaten, mocked, and scorned, bowing to the Father's will, he took a crown of thorns. Oh, that love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Sent of heaven, God's own Son, to purchase and your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah.
1 Corinthians 15, 1-4.
Yeah, he's good. He's good. Lead us into those scriptures, Wes. Loud and clear.
1 Corinthians 15, 1-4. Let me now remind you, dear brothers and sisters, of the good news I preached to you before. You welcomed it then, and you still stand firm in it. It is the good news that saves you, and if you continue to believe the message I told you, unless, of course, you believe something that was never true in the first place. I passed on to you what was most important and what had also been passed on to me. Christ died for our sins, just as the scripture said. He was buried and raised from the dead on the third day, just as the scripture said.
1 Corinthians 15, 12 through 19. But tell me this, since we preached that Christ rose from the dead, why are some of you saying there will be no resurrection of the dead? For there is no resurrection of the dead. For if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, then all of our preaching is useless and your faith is useless. And we apostles would all be lying about God. But we have said that God raised Christ from the grave, but that can't be true if there is no resurrection of the dead.
And if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless and you are still guilty of your sins. In that case, all who have died believing in Christ are lost. And if our hope in Christ is only for this life, we are more to be pitied than anyone in the world.
1 Corinthians 15, 57-58. But thank God, He gives us glory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. So my dear brothers and sisters, be strong and immovable. Always work enthusiastically for the Lord, for you know that nothing you do for the Lord is ever useless.
Suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is He. Hands that healed nations, stretched out on a tree, and He took the nails for me. Living He loved me, dying He saved me. Buried He carried my sins far away. Rising He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. Arose over death. ascended, my Lord evermore. Death could not hold him, grave could not keep him from rising again. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day, glorious day. One day the trumpet will sound for his coming. One day the skies with his glories will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved one singing, my Savior Jesus is mine. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day, oh glorious day, oh glorious day.
Christ is Heaven, Father, we just thank you this morning for your grace and your resurrection, Lord, and we just thank you that we can go through this life just with the hope of your future and eternity. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Seated.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome, and happy Resurrection Day to you. So, I don't know if you were here last week in the second service inside. We had a really bizarre event that occurred. So, in fact, I don't know if we've ever had it occur during a service, but we had folks who were either out in the parking lot for various reasons, and they were listening, or they were at home listening, but they weren't listening live. And all that they heard me say was, get that demon Satan out of here. Well, see, what had happened was a starling had flown into the building and was flying around the sanctuary, and so people didn't know what was going on. And then next I said, open the doors and get Satan out. So they thought we were having some sort of maybe Pentecostal service going on inside. So that was crazy. This morning when we got here early at 6 o'clock to get set up, a truck was jackknifed in front of the church driveway. Uh-oh. And some people couldn't get in. The tow truck guy got here, and that all got taken care of. So we're fortunate that we're able to meet. Then on top of that, Jamie and Gail, who were doing music just a few seconds ago, they got the word yesterday from me that the family that was supposed to be leading music today all got sick. So I want to thank you guys for stepping up and doing the music for us today. That was great. And thanks to all of you for getting up. Good morning, Bruce and Donnie, as well. And where is Wilson and Pat? Great to see you guys this morning as well. They have been, we've been neighbors for 22 years, and love seeing them. And Pat and I go way back to the beginning of this church when we put the building in 2004. She helped us with getting all of our water permit stuff done, and yeah, it's a blessing. So we're really glad that you're here today. So we had some scripture read this morning. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, classic text in the Bible. But the setup for that is really quite unusual. You're all familiar with the scene that leads up to this week, the triumphal entry a week ago. Jesus is entering into the city of Jerusalem. The palm branches are laid down. The clothes are being laid out as well. And Jesus goes into the city, And the same time that that's going on, there's another procession that's going on the west side. He enters from the east side through the Mount of Olives, through the Kidron Valley, up the other side and into the east side where the temple is in Jerusalem. But on the west side, Pontius Pilate is also entering in. He's entering in pomp and circumstance, in all of his glory. As the governor of Judea, he would typically come to the city of Jerusalem once a year during the Passover, which typically fell around what we now know as resurrection time. Both of these events are happening. Jesus stays in the city for the rest of the week, and of course you know the rest of the story. By the time Thursday, Friday come along, he's being crucified, and then on the first day of the week, he rises again from the dead. Now, that might be a given for you and me when we've come today. But for the church in Corinth, from the scriptures that we read today, that was absolutely not something that many of these folks wanted to believe in. If you picture the city of Corinth, which is centered 40 miles west of Athens in Greece, it was one of the centers for philosophical thought. And most of the people there, when they heard about the resurrection. You got to remember, the book of 1 Corinthians was written in the early to mid-50s, so about 20 years after the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. So many of the people that were in Corinth, not only were they pagans, but they wanted nothing to do with the idea of religion. In fact, the city of Corinth was known today as literally the Las Vegas of Greece, because of all of the issues that were going on in the city. It may have been known for a philosophical center, but it was also a center for absolute and total debauchery. And this is the scene that 1 Corinthians was written in. And by the time you get to chapter 15, Paul has answered a tremendous amount of questions that these new believers that were coming out of all of this paganism and all of this junk and all of this garbage were now being thrust into this idea of literally having their entire eternity and destiny, all of their eggs, if you will, thrown into one basket. Everything was going to rest on Jesus. And many in the city didn't want to hear it. But those that were coming to faith in Christ had this question. What happens to us after we die? We've heard about this resurrection thing, but all that we hear about in the city and all that we've grown up with this great philosophical thought is nothing like that exists. And now you're telling us that one guy came to die for us, rose again from the dead, and now we can have the same promise if we've trusted in him? And Paul says, absolutely, 100%. In fact, he says this. The Christianity that you have just embraced, the Jesus that you've just proclaimed to believe in, makes no sense whatsoever without this promise of eternity. I mean, it's just religion. It's just another thing of philosophical thought that you can just dump in the hopper like all of the other ones that you've listened to all of your life. And so what he does in chapter 15 in the first four verses, he reiterates for them the blessings of the gospel. He says, do you remember when I first came to you and I shared this whole idea with you, how that Jesus came and that he died and that he was buried and that he rose again? This is the thing that you can trust and believe in without a shadow of a doubt. There's no question about it. And so I want to break down those first four verses with you. Just a little bit. This whole idea of the triumph and the testimony of the gospel message. It says, this gospel, which I gave to you, is that which saves you. And don't ever forget that. And that's a reminder of why we're here today. We come and we love this season. We love the holidays. We love to do things as families. But I'm telling you, if this day doesn't happen, everything that you and I say you believe in means nothing. Absolutely nothing. I mean, the resurrection is what the gospel hangs on. Everything about today means everything about what you and I believe in. And then what's really interesting is he then breaks this down. He talks about it, and he goes through each little step. He says, Jesus has died for you. And what's interesting, the verb in the original language there is in the aorist tense. What he's saying was there was a point in time, and for their case, it was about 20 years prior to him coming to them. There was a point in time where Jesus came and he died. It was done. You remember what he said on the cross. It is finished. And then the next phrase was, and he was buried. That's also in the aorist tense. Very interesting. It means there was a point in time where then he was taken off the cross, and then he was put in the tomb. But what is really awesome is the next phrase. It then says, and he was risen from the dead, not in the aorist tense. It's the perfect tense use of the verb. And what's interesting about that is, so we had the 2 points in time, and then when Paul says to them, but he has risen from the dead, the perfect tense means there was a situation that occurred in the past, but the events of that and the reality of that continue to this very day. And for them, that was right then when he was talking to them. And for you and me, it means that the events of that day and the results of the resurrection are still alive and well for you and me today. The fact that he is risen and the blessings of that and what that means still continues. That means that when you and I share the gospel, even today, with people who have not believed for whatever reason, they've grown up in this world, or they've grown up in a different nation, and they maybe have heard different things, that means the validity of that event that occurred over 2,000 years ago is still viable today. We'll use a big word. It is still efficacious today for those who receive it and trust it. It means it still has the power to change your life and my life. So he talks about this beauty of the gospel. Well, then he goes on, as the Brooks family was reading in verses 12 through 19, they also talked about this whole idea of what it means to triumph in the resurrection. And there are so many things that he talks about. He says, listen, if the resurrection doesn't occur, then your preaching is in vain. In other words, the sharing of our testimony is in vain. It means nothing. Then your faith is also vain. And then he lists all of these things that mean absolutely nothing. The testimony of the apostles, ridiculous. The rest of your life is completely and utterly meaningless if we name that as part of our Christian testimony. But what I like to do is I like to turn that around. Instead of looking at the tragedy of no resurrection, I like to look at it as the triumph of the resurrection. Meaning that our testimony does have validity, and your faith does have validity. The word that's used there is an interesting phrase. It means that which was useless. So in other words, if the resurrection doesn't occur, it means everything that we believe in is useless. The word means to be without content. It means that we're like just blowing in the wind. We're just like another religious system that's out there. But what's really, really fantastic is that what you and I say we believe in does have content. In fact, you're resting your entire life on this. You have put all of your eggs in one basket. Now, I realize from a financial sense, that doesn't make sense, right? Anybody that has a financial advisor here says, you know, you need to diversify. You need to make sure you've got stocks, and you've got bonds, and you've got real estate, and you've got whatever it is. Yeah, maybe a little risk here and some safety over here. But when it comes to Christianity, you don't have to worry about diversification. It all comes down to one thing. Your faith and your testimony and your witness is literally based on this one thing. You're willing to go to the mat on this one area because of what this day means. And God wants us to be willing to do that. Not only as we raise our precious kids and our grandchildren and the co-workers that we have and the neighbors that we meet, whatever it is, you and I are going to be willing to go to the mat for this one thing because of what happened on this day. And then finally, as he goes through the rest of that chapter, talking to the people about the importance of the resurrection. In fact, he goes ad nauseum. The whole chapter deals with this one particular event. He ends it with two of the greatest verses, in my opinion, in all of Scripture. And that is verses 57 and 58. He says, so what if all of this is true? He says, don't lose heart, my beloved brethren. Whatever you do, do everything to the glory of God. In other words, and that all of what you do is not in vain. Nothing is in vain. How does this then affect what we do. If we have the triumph of the resurrection and the testimony of the gospel, how do we take this, what I'll call the tools for the daily grind of life? What does this mean for daily living? How do you and I take this belief system that we have and put it to work for us? I think it's pretty clear that it helps us to understand that our life has to be filtered through a grid that has the death, burial, and resurrection in mind. In other words, it gives place to understanding the reality of the life in which we live. So many people wake up each day and they're like, is this it? Especially as we get older, we put a little mileage on our life. And we come down to the end of things and we say, wait a minute, was it all about the houses and the money and the work and the stuff? Well, the answer to that is absolutely not. It's not about any of those things. It's not about the temporalism that we face every single day. It's about looking forward to the eternity that we have in mind and moving forward. You know, how do we deal with that? You know, Gene, you just lost your wife recently. And now you, through the pain and the issues of daily suffering that brings, you look forward to you a reuniting, right? Because of the resurrection.
Amen.
These are the things now that suddenly make a whole lot of sense to us. Suddenly matter much more than maybe they might have 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 20 years ago. And that's what he's trying to tell the folks in the Corinthian church. This matters. Be unmovable, always serving the Lord in whatever we do, because we know, and what's interesting, he uses a very similar word at the very end of the chapter that he did in the beginning. He says, whatever we do now for the Lord, it is not useless. In other words, it is not in vain. So sometimes we're marching through life, and life can stink. There's all kinds of challenges. We get muddled down with death and loss and suffering and pain and politics and, oh, sorry, I had to bring that up one time. And all kinds of other junk that we deal with on a regular basis. Pandemics, losing our jobs, just raising our kids, the daily grind of getting up every day and asking ourselves, Lord, what is the most important thing in life? And Paul says to the people in this church, the people that came out of this pagan background, he says, it's all worth it. This belief of throwing all your eggs in one basket, to believe in this, is absolutely 100% worth it. And so we're willing to throw in the towel. When we get discouraged about issues and situations in life, it comes back and it says, you know what? Jesus did all of this for us. He died in a point in time. He was buried in a point in time. But the resurrection has continuing results. And those results give us encouragement and blessing to get up each day and view the world from a perspective that he wants us to see it through. A lens that he wants for our life. One that gives us peace and blessing and understanding when life around us seems like it's spiraling completely out of control. So we come today on a really awesome and fantastic morning to worship God and to continuously make sense of our Christianity. Because it doesn't make sense if eternity isn't real. If the resurrection doesn't happen, that this is all a joke. But we've been around enough to know that it isn't. Life really is worth living. Life really does have meaning and purpose behind it. And he wants us to be striving with the power of his Spirit in our life to live that out and to show the world around us that putting your eggs in one basket for the cause of your eternity and mine is not only right, but it's worth it. Let's continue to worship the Lord today as you enjoy your family festivities and throughout the rest of this year, keeping all of this in the right perspective for his glory. Let's pray. Lord, we're really just so blessed to be here today. Thank you for the sounds around us. Thank you for the privilege that we have to sing, to worship you, to honor you. Thank you that you are our Savior. And the results of that are still literally ringing through our lives this morning. We pray that we might carry this message with us as we raise our kids, as we share in testimony to those around us, as we endeavor to be salt and light in the world in front of us. God, God, may you be glorified in and through us, and may we be willing to praise you each and every day of our life. Help us to do that, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Why don't we go ahead and stand and sing the last couple of songs as we wrap things up.
Send us off with your great name and because he lives.
Lost are saved, find their way at the sound. This child can face uncertain days because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future and life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross the river, I'll fight life's final war with pain, and then as death gives way to
great singing. Thank you so much. I'm going to ask if Bruce David could wrap us up this morning with a word of prayer, please.
Lord, thank you for the beautiful morning and for the wonderful message that we heard. Let us leave this day and from here and go and spread your good news to people that may need to hear it, and that, as we heard, our faith is not in vain. And everything hangs on this day. We love what you've done for us, and we cannot wait until we see you, when our day comes, when we go to meet you. A glorious day. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for this fellowship. Thank you for putting us here at this time and place in the world. Let us go forth and speak your good news to those who need to hear it. In your name we pray.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, everybody, for coming today. Have a great rest of your day with your family. A fantastic week, and we'll see you next week. Next week.